Fundamentals of the faith. Over the past few weeks, we have looked at authority, we have looked at the matters of salvation, we have looked at worship, and today we're looking at really something that goes along the lines of Christian living. When we think about fundamentals of the faith, one of the most fundamental things we have to understand is what it means to live a life that's pleasing before God. You'll notice, as was read a moment ago there in Leviticus 19, verses 1 and 2, the Bible says, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Speak to all the congregation of the children of Israel, and say to them, You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." When I read those words, I think about the idea that God wants us to be like Him. He wants us to be without sin. We know, however, that man, because we have free will, because we're not perfect, we will make mistakes from time to time. But we can be holy, we can be a people who are set apart because we are not like the world. When we think about Christians, we know that we are set apart. That's what makes us God's people, is because we're not like the rest of the world. As we see here in Leviticus chapter 19, verses 1 and 2, how we are called to be holy. We also want to notice that in 1 Peter 1 and verse 15, we are called to be holy in all your conduct. Here in verse 15 he says, "But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct." Now we know that we're going to make mistakes. That's not what the scripture tells us. It doesn't tell us to be perfect, because we know we cannot be literally perfect. But we are to strive to rid our lives of sin. And when we do fall short, as we read there in the book of 1 John, that we can repent of our sins, and the blood of Jesus Christ will continue to cleanse us from all unrighteousness and give us the ability to again have fellowship with God. But we see here the idea is very clear. But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. When you think about all your conduct, that means when we think about what we do each and every day, when we get up in the morning, we begin making decisions right away. One of the first ones is if we're going to be happy or we're going to be grumpy. Sometimes we pick the wrong one. Sometimes we get up and we decide this is going to be the worst day ever before we even put our feet on the carpet, don't we? We get up, we're upset about something, maybe we had a bad night's rest, and the day is already going down the wrong path. You know, when that happens sometimes, it becomes much more easy to sin, because we get this attitude that we don't really care about what happens today. We're in a bad mood, and so we can be upset about something, and we continue to sin throughout the day. So when you think about this idea of conduct, you have to realize it begins the very first thing each and every morning. We also think about there in the book of Lamentations, our Bible tells us how the mercies of God are new every morning. Great is His faithfulness. So long as we have breath in our lungs, and until the Lord comes back, we are able to have each and every day to, you might say, to start over. To determine we're not going to allow today to be like yesterday. We can go to our Heavenly Father in prayer and ask Him to forgive us of those sins. And we can start this day differently than we did the day before. But we know we don't have to wait to the next day. We can end it a bad string of events right away and begin to stop and pray to God, ask Him to forgive us of our sins before we continue on with our day. But we have to realize it begins each and every day. And we think about immorality. There is one battle, you might say, above all, that we all have to deal with in our lives. There is a battle that every person must win. And Paul addresses one of the biggest moral problems, both then during his time period, and also still for us today. Sexual purity and the godly standard regarding such has been an issue from the very beginning of time, hasn't it? We go back, we look in the Old Testament, we see problems with sexuality and problems with purity all throughout the Old Testament. Over and over again, we see men and women struggle with it. In the New Testament, we see the same thing, don't we? Notice what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 16, verses 18 through 20. He says here, "Flee sexual immorality." The King James says, "fornication." Flee. Now, that's pretty simple for us to understand it. We would say, get away from it. Many times we use the illustration of Joseph going back with Potiphar's wife. And now the Bible says the Potiphar's wife was seeking after Joseph to lay with him day after day. And finally at one point she grabbed his cloak and he had to literally run outside and run away to get away from her. He literally fled from fornication. We too sometimes have to literally flee from fornication, don't we? We have to flee from those we may come in contact with, or maybe a little more friendly than they ought to be. We have to realize that we must realize that before us each and every day is a chance for sexual purity or this chance for sexual sin. We look here at verse 18. He says, every sin that a man does, it's outside the body. But he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. So many of those things we do today, they're sinful. They don't really harm us, you might say, physically. But some do. One of those things he mentions here is sexual immorality or fornication. He says it sins against his own body. Verse 19 says, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? This is why sexual immorality sins against the body, because our body is the temple of God. He says here in verse 20, for you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. What we do with our bodies can glorify God. It can also bring shame to God. You think about someone who gives their life over to do mission work or to preach or teach the gospel, to whatever it may be, these other righteous, good acts, and how they use their body to go to different places throughout the world, preaching and teaching and all these different things. Their body is bringing glory to God, isn't it? Because they're keeping it pure from sin, they're using their body while they have it on the earth to proclaim the gospel message. But the body can also bring shame upon the church, can it? Those involved in sexual sins, those involved in fornication, those involved in other immoral acts, and then claim to be a member of the body of Christ, can bring shame upon the body of Christ. He tells us in verse 20, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Well, let's get to another key point. We must realize the Bible defines what is moral, what is right. Many times today, and I think it's probably has gone on since the beginning of time, people have tried to redefine what is good, what is pleasing. In fact, you go through, and we'll see in here in a moment, you go through and look at some of these Old Testament passages. There are those who did what was right in their own eyes. Look at Jeremiah 10, verse 23, a verse we all have heard many times before. O Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man who walks to direct his own steps. Jeremiah 10, 23. What is Jeremiah saying? He's acknowledging. He says, O Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. He's saying, I know that I cannot get myself to follow you faithfully, doing only what I want to do. If the Christian life is based upon our own standards, we have already failed. Our standards must be the Word of God. He says here in verse 23, it is not in man who walks to direct his own steps, meaning we cannot get to heaven doing things our way, can we? We can only get to heaven by following the Word of God. He says, it's not in man who walks to direct his own steps, meaning it must be God who can lead us to eternal life. In Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9, here the Bible says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. That tells us that God does things differently than how we so often would do them. We hear people today say, when we talk to them about the Bible, they say, well, you know, that's just asking a whole lot. Imagine what God asked from His Son when He died on the cross. Wasn't that asking a whole lot of Him? And yet we see the Christian life. The Christian life is not the easiest life, but it's also the most rewarding, though, isn't it? We see there in verse 8, my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. He says in verse 9, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The Lord is telling us that His ways, His standards of living are on a much higher plane than ours. One of the things I notice during the inauguration and all these different protests going on is people live on a totally different standard than each other, don't they? You have those on one standard of living, and I'm not talking about financial. And you have those on another standard, and those on another standard, and those on another standard. What do you find? Those who are living in sin. Some are engrossed in it. Some have problem with a few things. Some have problem with a lot of things. And some are trying to live the Christian life. You have different standards of living today, but we notice there's only one standard of living that can get us into heaven, and that's doing things according to God's standard. He says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, that shows us how much higher His ways are than ours. You ever ask a fisherman how big their fish was that they caught? It's always huge, right? It's always a big fish until you see the picture of it, and sometimes you realize their standard of measuring is a lot different than ours. They say it's like this. The picture says it's more like this. Well, that's how it is here with God and His Word. His standard is much higher than ours. You can't even begin to measure it. He says it's higher, as the heavens are higher than the earth. That shows us how much more and how much better His standards are. He says, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And still yet, we still hear some say, well, it just seems right. Well, that doesn't always mean anything, does it? Proverbs 14, verse 12. There's a way that seems right to man, but its end is a way of death. You ever try to fix something and it seems like the right way to do it? And you get all put together, and maybe then you go and plug in. What happened? You realize that wasn't the right way? Something pops, something short circuits, something doesn't come on, light doesn't come on, whatever it may be. That wasn't the right way to do it, was it? There's a way that seems right to man. But its end, what is he talking about? The end result of that way that seems right to man, the end result is death. And we know if we are going our own way, the end result being death means we are eternally separated from God because we have done things our own way. There was a singer years ago, Frank Sinatra. Remember a song he used to sing? I did things, did it my way. On the day of judgment, I have to answer that, won't he? No matter how popular he was, that's not the way that gets us to heaven. Doing things our own way. Some will say, well, it isn't against the law. Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Notice what Peter says. And Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Some will say, well, alcohol isn't against the law. Does that mean we should partake in it? Tobacco isn't against the law. Does that mean we should partake in it? You know, fornication, cheating on your spouse, isn't against the law either, is it? But it doesn't mean we should partake in it, does it? Peter says here, and most of the Bible says, Peter and the other apostles. I mean, he wasn't alone when he said this to this leader. He responded, we ought to obey God rather than men. Do you remember the occasion? They were trying to tell Peter and the other apostles to basically be quiet. Stop going out and preaching and teaching. Just be quiet. They basically gave them a slap on the wrist and sent them away. Remember what happened after that? Peter and the apostles went and told everybody else. What happened? They prayed. The Bible says they were filled with boldness. They went out and did what? Were quiet? No, they preached the Word of God with even more boldness. Why? Because they understood fully they ought to obey God rather than the laws of men. We think about immorality. We know that there are spiritual consequences of immorality. You know, everything in life has consequences. You forget to pay your taxes, there are consequences. You forget to put oil in your car, there are consequences. You forget to renew a tag on your car, there are consequences. All types of things result in consequences based on our action or inaction in life. When it comes to the spiritual realm, it's the same way. What we do has consequences. What we choose not to do also has consequences. We know, for example, Romans 6, verse 23, that sin has a price. For the wages of sin is death. That's the law. You sin, you deserve to die. Look what the Bible says in verse 23. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. For the wages of sin is death. You sin lawfully, you should die. But Christ, what? Because He loves mankind, because God loves mankind, He gave mankind an ability to escape the death that came with their sin. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Also, we think about not only are there spiritual consequences, but there also are, you might say, consequences among those around us. For example, immorality destroys a person's good name and their integrity. In Proverbs 22 and verse 1, the Bible says, "A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches, loving favor than silver and gold." He's saying it's better to have what? A good rapport, we say, among the people around us than to be wealthy. It's better to be respected for doing what is right than to be wealthy, to have great riches or to have silver and gold. A good name. How do you get a good name? By doing what is right. You know, sometimes you get a bad name by doing what is right. But you don't in the eyes of God, do you? You get that good name. A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches. Loving favor, meaning people respect you. They love you because of what you do, what you don't do, what you stand for, all those types of things. And those are worth more than earthly riches. Too many times we care too much about what people think about us, and we allow that to cause us to make decisions that are not pleasing inside of God. We must remember a good name before God is much more important. But also immorality, the sin of immorality, destroys a person emotionally. Look at Psalm 32, noticing verses 1 through 4. Here the Bible says, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is a man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long." What is he talking about? He seems to be talking about that before the Lord forgave him of these things, forgave him of sin. He says in verse 3, "I kept silent." He didn't bring his sin before God. He says, "My bones grew old through all my groaning all the day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer." Saying, "What? I grew weak because I did not come before you asking for forgiveness of sins." He grew weak, physically and emotionally weak. When we are in sin, sometimes there are those who fall into a state of depression because they realize they're in sin and they're not bold enough to come out of it. But notice what verses 1 and 2 says in the same text. "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered." If it's forgiven, if it's covered, it's no longer held against us, is it? "Blessed is a man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit." We must make sure we repent of any immorality. Well, let's think about some lessons for us today. One of the fundamentals of Christianity is proper morals. Without proper morals, man cannot be faithful to God. If we set the standard of morality ourselves, we're going to fall short. So sometimes you hear people say, "Well, that's what my mother and father always did. That's what grandma and grandpa used to do." So, you know, we realize if we did that, some of us probably wouldn't be here today. Because we'd say, "Well, our denominational faith is what my mother and father used to do, so that's where I go." In fact, in South Carolina, one man talked about over and over again how he was putting with a friend to come and to just visit with us. And he said, "We can't. We've always gone here." That's not a good enough answer, is it? Look at Proverbs 21 and verse 2. "Every way of man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the hearts." Every way of man is right in his own eyes. Every man thinks they're right, right? You can ask your spouse. We always think we're right in our way of doing things. But before God, we know that we may think we're right, but it doesn't mean we actually are. He says, "But the Lord weighs the hearts." Every way of man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the hearts. Man may please himself with his morals, but God decides if it is right or wrong. If man is going to be faithful to God, we cannot do so doing things our own way. To be a follower of Christ, one must follow his word, his laws and his commandments, and not just, you might say, the dictates of our own heart. Notice Proverbs chapter 18, verses 1 and 2. The Bible says, "A man who isolates himself seeks his own desire. He rages against all wise judgment. A fool has no delight in understanding, but in expressing his own heart. It seems, this verse seems to show what is so often true, that man despises righteousness and only wants to do what he himself wants to do. You know, sometimes we hear people say, well, there's no talking to that man. You know, sometimes that's sad, especially when we're talking about a brother in Christ. There's no talking to that man. We sit down and try to have a rational conversation with that person about some issue, open up our Bibles, and we come away saying there's no talking to that man. Well, notice what he says here in verse 1. A man who isolates himself seeks his own desire. A man who what? Wants to be left alone, wants to do what they want to do, don't they? We all know those we have begged and pleaded to come back and do that which is right, but they basically, in the end, want to be left alone. He rages against all wise judgment. That is, he what? He rebukes and tries to argue with those who try to show that person the way from the Word of God because they seek their own desire. Notice verse 2, a fool has no delight in understanding. They have no delight in seeing what God wants them to do and requires them to do to have eternal life. They have no desire in it. They have no delight in it. But instead, in verse 2, he says, but in expressing his own heart. Some just want to tell you what they're going to do, and they're not going to change. Several years ago, I was introduced to a couple when we were in South Carolina. And we were talking with them, and they basically came, I can't remember how often, it was just once, maybe twice. And I remember the first time I met them, they wanted us to come and talk with him. So we drove and visited with this person and told us, well, we spend our mornings with GBN. We understand what GBN is, the Gospel Broadcasting Network. Good work, we support it. But they themselves also will tell you that we are not a substitute for Sunday morning worship. In fact, on Sunday mornings, they will probably tell you, and I know you can find their website, their purpose is to be there for those who cannot physically make it out to a worship service. They are not a substitute. In fact, on the OEBS, the Online Academy of Biblical Studies, who I work with, on Sundays, you go to their page, they offer all these different streams of live worship service. The first thing you'll see is we are not trying to replace Sunday morning worship. Why? Because they're there if you can't get out. But if you can, they tell you basically you need to be here. We have those who argue against sound wisdom. He says here in verse 1, he rages against all wise judgment. For some, there is no talking to them. But let us not be like that individual. Those pleasing to God will stand upon God's moral standards. That is, we'll see what God says is moral and immoral, and we'll base our life upon that. God's standards. Let us teach others to do the same, guiding them in God's morals, using His Word, not what we think God has said, but actually show them what God has said. As you think about these things this morning, man needs to hear the gospel and not the desires of his own heart. In fact, in Romans 10, verse 17, the Bible says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by hearing the Word of God. And so what do we need to do? We need to hear the gospel and stop listening to our own selfish desires. Man also must not believe in his own selfish and wicked ways, but instead believe in Christ as the Son of God. You know, sometimes people today believe in their wicked ways much more than they do the Word of God, and much more than they do in Christ as the Son of God. John 8, verse 24 says, therefore I said to you that you will die in your sins if you do not believe that I am He. You will die in your sins if we do not believe that Christ is the Son of God. Man must repent of his sinful and wicked ways to please God. Man can never please the world. Have you noticed that, how hard people try to please the world? And how many times, how short-lived, if they can accomplish it, how short-lived it is. You notice throughout the media how people turn on one another faster than a kid wanting someone else's toy. They turn on one another quickly and many times very violently. But man must repent of his sinful and wicked ways to please God. And we must remember, man can never please the world. Luke 13, verses 4 and 5 says, or these 18 on whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them, do you think they were worse sinners than all men who dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell you, no, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. What? You must repent of your sins. You're not better than anybody else we too must repent of our sins. When man confesses that Christ is the Son of God, we also confess He is the only way to eternal life. He is the only way to eternal life. John 12, verse 42 says, "Nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed in Him. But because of the Pharisees, they did not confess Him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue." They would not confess Christ as the Son of God, but we must confess Him. The Bible goes on to say there in verse 43, they love the praise of men more than the praise of God. They wanted to please others more, and they would not confess Christ as the Son of God. The act of baptism is the only act that washes away the spots that sin leaves on man. We think about the numerous times we've sung the song and read the verses from Isaiah talking about how though our sins be as scarlet, meaning being as scarlet, he says they should be as wool. How do they become as wool? When we are washed in the blood of Christ. Acts 22, verse 16 says, "Now, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." How do we wash away our sins? At baptism. And we must remember that. When man continues in life as a faithful servant of God, he guarantees himself that he will see God. When we faithfully follow God, when we repent of our sins, when we make mistakes, because we know we will throughout our lives, but when we repent of those things and we strive to remain faithful to God, we will have heaven as our home. Revelation 2 and verse 10 says, "Do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested, and you will have a tribulation 10 days. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life." If we remain faithful to God. Immorality should be no excuse for not remaining faithful to God. We can repent of our sins and be faithful to God. This morning, as you think about these things, we have seen the plan of salvation, how we must hear the gospel, not the dictates of our own heart. We have seen the necessity of believing in Christ as the Son of God. We have seen the requirement of repentance and confessing that Christ is the Son of God. We have seen that we must be baptized so that our sins can be washed away. And we see here in Revelation 2, verse 10, we must remain faithful until death if we plan to have heaven as our home. Immorality is a very strong series of things that can come upon us and tempt us to pull us away from Christ, various actions and ways of life. There's only one way of life that can be pleasing to God, and that's the Christian life, the life that follows God's word and follows His commands. This morning, if we can help you anyway, come forward now. Let's get up and stand and sing the song that's been selected.